Hey folks, this video is going to be a response to a message that I got in YouTube from someone. I like doing responses in a video. He states, "Hello, I have a serious question for you, and please, it is not in text, so don't ignore my statements and questions. Ponder them as serious as you would anyone else. Ready? Why would you disable comments for your Emerald Cockroach Wasp video? Is it because your one and only theory that God gave this little creature directions on how to reproduce could easily be rebuffed?" Okay, you meant rebuttaled. "By so many people, even an average non-theist like myself? No, it's because I have a personal policy. For the first 2 years or so that I used YouTube, made videos, atheists didn't like what I had to say, and evolution pushers either. And so your videos, when you stir up a mess with these people, because you have things to say that they don't like, what you'll find is oftentimes your videos will get a rash of negative comments from atheists and evolutionists. The thing is, this is my YouTube channel, and if somebody wants to preach materialism, godlessness, and evolutionism, they're welcome to do that on their own backyard, from their own channel. I don't allow it from mine. Text debate is mindless. It's a horrible waste of time. So don't expect me to get into a debate with anybody in text format. Many evolutionists want to do this because they need time to package their assumptions into an argument, because they're not capable of giving strong evidence or rebuttaling evidences on the fly. But I have no interest in such things. It's a waste of time. And my videos are for helping people learn the truth. They're not a playground for atheists to preach godlessness and evolutionists to push the mindless theory of evolution. So that's why. Has nothing to do with fear of anything, because I have an ongoing statement of an open door policy about debate. I'm willing to debate just about anybody in Skype, verbally, or some other format. I've debated many times. I do. It's something that I enjoy doing. So I'm always available for debate, pretty much. I mean, if I have the time in the evenings, if somebody can arrange to debate with me, I'd be happy to. So it's not like I fear anything. Why if I debate and am willing to put my debates on the internet, what is it that I fear? No, I don't fear anything. I just don't let atheists and evolutionists turn my YouTube channel into a post where they're, you know, for their preaching. They can do that on their own yard. Evolution is exactly why the reason the wasp acts that way, this way. No, it's not. It can't be, because the animal doesn't learn it from birth, from its parents. It's not taught, and it can't be learned trial and error. The procedures that the emerald cockroach wasp goes through to survive and reproduce cannot have been learned, because each step in that complex process must succeed. If any one of them failed, reproduction for the wasp would fail, and the organism would not exist. So trial and error cannot explain it, because there's a lot of ways that the roach could simply fail. Secondly, once the roach has learned this, it's not passed on to its offspring. There's no classrooms where these wasps sit around with their offspring and say, "Now, all right, listen up, kids. This is how you do it. First, you got to sting the roach in the ganglia on this side, and that's going to instill a grooming reflex." See, it doesn't have any, there's no wasp classrooms. The wasps do not teach this to their offspring. The organism knows it from birth. So it can't be passed on. Imagine the first wasp that managed to succeed at this complex series of tasks necessary for its reproduction. Now what? The next wasp has to try trial and error all over again for it to survive. Or the same wasp. And guess what that would be? Well, that would almost certainly fail, because any failure of any one of the steps in this long, complex process would result in a failure, and the organism would not be able to reproduce. See, so you're back to square one. Evolutionists relying on their insane love of outrageous odds and randomness. See, it's just not logical that the organism would ever succeed, because it's likely they would fail at any one of those series of steps. To get all of them right, the odds are outrageous, astronomical, that they would not fail at any one of those things. Or that the wasp couldn't even know that stinging it twice is the way to go, one in one part of its brain and then another time in another. How would the wasp even learn that? See, it's nonsense believing it. No, its creator gave him the wasp. God gave the animal this knowledge to proceed with this complex step, series of steps in order to reproduce. It's not learned from the offspring. Now, the only other potential for the evolutionist is to believe that the wasp learns, one of them somehow succeeds at this, okay, a miracle happens, a naturalistic miracle, and then somehow it's able to pass this knowledge on. That's what evolution would contend. This knowledge is passed on. Well, how is that going to happen? We know the wasps don't teach their offspring this procedure. They're born with it. They do it from birth. These wasps are not even social creatures, I don't believe. They're loners. When they're born, they're out on their own. There's no way for that to succeed, because there's no way for the wasp to pass this knowledge on to its offspring. The evolutionist would have to, for that to be so, the evolutionist would have to believe that behavior becomes encoded as digital information in their DNA and then passed on to offspring. But we don't know of any such mechanism for such a thing. It's irrational to believe that. See. So, no, there is no potential basis for evolution to explain the emerald cockroach wasp, or in fact, any living thing. Okay, continuing. Why not just hear people out? Oh, I have. I've heard out every imaginable claim of evolution theory, thought them through, and discovered their mindlessness. They're anti-science, not science, and they're refuted by science. Maybe you would learn something that you truly didn't know about the wasp instead of making a biased view and claiming it as truth. No, it's the thing is that you're stuck with an inability to explain this behavior in this wasp with your evolution theory, and it frustrates you that you hear somebody giving a logical, rational account for how it could be that the organism is capable of this. I know you don't like it. Evolutionists, they just despise the truth. It is for this reason alone that we atheists publicly are speaking out so impatiently with you guys. No, the reason the atheists have become militant and even vicious in the last 15 or so years is because there has been an outpouring of scientific argument and philosophical argument from Christians which refute the basis of evolution theory, materialism, determinism, moral relativism, and everything else that atheists claim is true. It's because they've been so thoroughly rebutted, that their worldview has been so thoroughly discredited, that they have become angry, even some are vicious. It's because of the pressure of society, of people looking upon atheists and seeing them as unintellectual denialists. They don't like that, and so they're mad about it. I understand that, but that's really what's going on here. It's just plain ludicrous that you would state any state facts in which there's no physical evidence. There's all the physical evidence. The organism is not taught these procedures. There's no mechanism by which this behavior, learned set of procedures, could be encoded as digital information in the DNA as genes and then passed on and then turned back into knowledge in the organism. See? That's nonsense. There's no potential mechanism for it. The organism knows how to do this from birth because it's in the organism's design from the beginning. That's just all there is to that. It's clear. I do not, let's see here. You do not know how the wasp became that way. Yes, I do. It was created that way. Its creator made it. I do not either. But at least my beliefs are based on research and not faith. That's not true because there is no research that shows how the wasp could have learned it. And this behavior become genes, which then becomes knowledge in the offspring of every creature after it. No science demonstrates that's possible or true. Your idea that the wasp was a product of evolution is not based on science. It's not based on research. It is based on absolute blind faith, in fact. It's not in the Bible. Okay, so it's not in the Bible. Doesn't make a difference. Or perhaps there's some message that you can quote me where it states specifically that this is how this one insect will behave. That's a really a straw man argument. We don't have to show that something is in the Bible for it to be considered true within Christianity or scientifically within creation. Do you read published scientific journals about insects to find out the true trial and error phase of their existence? I have read, and I understand that trial and error does not work, as I've explained. A failure of any one of the steps along the way, and the roach, the wasp fails to reproduce. That's a failure for the organism, and it would cause extinction for the organism to try, for all of them to try to learn trial and error. The only other potential for this to do this, the only other potential is for this behavior to become encoded as information in the DNA, which is then somehow translated back as knowledge in the mind of the wasp, the offspring of the wasp. That's an illogical, that's irrational way to think about that. There's no reason to believe such a ludicrous thing as that. And so there is no potential for nature to explain the behaviors of the emerald cockroach wasp or any other living thing. There is nothing evolution can do to provide a cause for the existence of anything at all, not biological or otherwise. By the way, there is no such thing as Nephilim or giants. As a matter of fact, 99.9% of theologians simply believed they were just ordinary men. That's false. That number is false. It would be vastly lower than that. Eschatologists believe, know this too, and they don't dare admit it to you. I disagree with that statement too. The language in the Bible is quite specific. It leaves no doubt as to what these men were about, and who they were, what they were like. They were brutes, they were abnormally large, and the Bible describes it with certain detail. Let me give you an example here in Deuteronomy 3. Now the same word is here for giant is used throughout the Bible, and it means a brute, but it can also mean giant. But how do we know that it's meaning not just men who are brutes, but giants? Well, here it is in Deuteronomy 3. In fact, the Old Testament is littered with statements about giant men. And this was a common theme, because there were, in those days, giants. Here it states, in verse 11, "For only Og, king of Bashan, remained of the remnants of the giants," in that tribe of people, is what they're referring to. "Behold, his bed was a bedstead of iron," not wood. So you can check that out. "And is it not in Rabbath of the children of Ammon?" In other words, do we not still have this bed today? Do we not still know of it? Do not people come and see it? Do we not know this bed? Yes, the bed was still existing in this day. Saying, is the bed not in Rabbath? Have we not seen it? Do men not go look at it to this day? This is what the words are meaning. "Is it not in Rabbath of the children of Ammon? 9 cubits was the length thereof, and 4 cubits the breadth thereof, after the cubit of a man." A cubit is an ancient measurement from the elbow to the tip of the fingers, and it varied slightly from one culture to another. A Hebrew cult cubit would be slightly different from an Egyptian one. But it's roughly about 18 inches. Now, if you do the math, this was a very big man. Here he's got a bed of metal that is 9 cubits in length. That's a bed for a man that's 10, 12 feet tall. See? Now, the Bible also elsewhere states many things about giants, and it states that the Hebrews went into Jericho they sent spies into Jericho to find out what, you know, strength their enemy was, and what weaponry they had, how many there were, what these men were like that they were about to go up against in war. And they stayed that they were like grasshoppers in the sight of these men. That's poetic language, of course, but it's being serious at the same time. You know, if today two men said, "Man, that guy was like a giant. You know, I was like a grasshopper in that guy's sight." Well, today, what giants would we be talking about? Well, we'd be talking about abnormally large men, 7, 7.5 feet tall. There are some. even a few that approach 8 feet, I think. But this is not the kind of men we're talking about. How big were these men? Men that slept on a bed that was 9 cubits in length. A big man. A really, really big, big man. A 1,000 plus pound man. A man with an arm capable of lifting 1,000 pounds by just curling it. I'm talking about a very large man. A minimum 8 feet, possibly 12 or more feet tall. How do we know? Because of what the Bible, how it describes them. See? So, yes, the Bible does literally discuss giants, and it means giants when it calls them giants. It means brutish, outrageously large men who set themselves up as rulers over other men because of their great size. The record of giants existing in this world throughout the histories of the world is extensive. The ancients carved many images of their kings slaying normal-sized men who were waist-high or a little higher to these men. The Egyptians did it. The Greeks did it. The Babylonians, Sumerians, and Akkadians did it. The Chinese did it. In various cultures around the world throughout history, man has depicted artistically kings slaying unruly subjects who were as small to them as a 4-year-old child is to a 30-year-old man. Okay, so you can say, I don't believe there is a giant or ever has been in this world. That's fine. You're welcome to your belief. But as for what the statements in the Bible are regarding giants, they're literally giants. The Bible's absolutely clear on the matter. They were abnormally large men, very large men. Okay, back to your message. Let's see. Eschatologists know this too. Let's see. They were certainly not fallen angels that made love to the daughters of men and popped out Philistines. No. Well, you say no, I say yes. Okay. But in fact, the Bible Hebrew Nephilim is not translated as the word giant. It means, yes, I pointed that out already. It means brute. Bully, tyrant. Here it is. Right there. Bully, tyrant, brute. But it means giant too. How do we know? Because King Og was a remnant of the giants, and his bedstead was made of iron. A man that weighs 1,000 pounds or more needs a bed of iron or some serious timbers. Imagine a 1,000-pound man flopping down on his bed because he's tired or exhausted. You better make it out of some serious wood. Better yet, make it out of iron. Okay, so the Bible is clear. There were giants in the world. That's absolutely clear. You can't just go by the word Nephilim or Nephil in the Bible and say it means brutes alone, because clearly I've demonstrated with other passages in the Bible that the Bible is speaking literally of giant men. So, let's see here. See, that wasn't so bad now, was it? Have a nice day. Okay, well, you see, so there's my response to you. The emerald cockroach wasp, nor any other organic thing in this world, is explainable by naturalistic cause. It's all information-driven. Life is information-driven. Information is an immaterial thing created by mind. Matter, naturalistic causes, cannot produce information, algorithms, linguistics law, or any of the things that we see in DNA. To believe that random naturalistic causes has produced a cell is absurdity. It's like believing that if you that the space shuttle is going to arise by happenstance occurrences in matter. Just give it enough time. It's nonsense. Time is not the hero of the plot. Evolutionists often claim that it is. When I debate evolutionists, I constantly hear them appealing to time as the hero, the fixer of their flawed theory with its countless holes. Well, you just don't have enough faith in time. You don't understand that it takes a long time. We hear this time rant from evolutionists all the time. Time doesn't fix it. For example, the odds of a medium-sized protein, all right, that's just, you know, the largest human protein known to exist has 34,000 plus amino acids. Each one of a specific type in a specific location in that chain to produce that specific molecular machine, which interacts specifically with other specific molecular machines in a cell so that the cell can function and live. 34,000 amino acids in a chain necessary in their order for that protein to fold into the specific structure that makes that machine. Now, the odds of a single small protein, medium-sized, let's say 3,000 amino acids. The odds that that could arise by naturalistic chance to form a protein that has function is astronomical. It's not even worth considering. It would be a one with a page of zeros behind it. A whole page of zeros. A number greater than all the particles of matter in the observable known universe. That's called odds that are impossible. The statistical analysis of odds tells scientists whether a thing is plausible or not. It is utterly implausible, therefore, since we're talking about a number so great it requires a page full of zeros. That's called mathematically impossible times impossible times impossible. It's what mathematicians would refer to as mathematically considered impossible. Anyway, so there you have it. I hope you enjoyed my response. God bless.